My name is Ekta Patel, and I'm a graduate student at Steward Observatory, and going into my fifth year of a PhD, and I'm hoping to graduate in May of 2019. I had remembered that I thought about astronomy in high school at some point, and I was like, oh, somebody must do this as a real career. So when I went to college, I did my little Googling, just like, how do I become an astronomer? And the answer was either major in astronomy, if it's possible, or physics. So I started physics, and I didn't like it. I had taken a physics class in high school, and it was fine. I didn't, particularly love it, and I didn't hate it. So when I came to college, in addition to, all the transitions you go through while you're, starting a whole new chapter of your life, finally, near the end of sophomore year, I started to do research. So one of my classmates had started working with a professor at NYU who's an astronomer, and he knew that I wanted to start research, but he started doing this work and said, oh, this professor's also looking for another student to work on the same project so we can work on different parts of it together. Would you be interested? So he kind of just roped me into it, and I got an invitation to go to this research meeting and meet this professor that I knew about, and I was just I can't work with this person, they're too popular. That definitely helped, because the struggling with courses never completely went away. So it was nice to have a different part of, academia that I could participate in that would let me do the astronomy even if I wasn't loving all the coursework that I needed to get there. There's a range in mass that we know of, and the most massive ones are things that are 10% of the mass of their host. So in the Milky Way's case, the Large Magellanic Cloud is the biggest one, by mass at least. And so it's about 10% of the Milky Way. And then in M31 or Andromeda, there's M33. Which is also about 10% of its mass. So I tend to care about the orbital evolution of the satellite galaxies and sort of what the history of them is in terms of, how long have they been orbiting around their host? What kind of orbit are they on in terms of shape? And then what are the implications of that? Because these satellite galaxies eventually are what merges into the host galaxies to help the galaxy grow. So we pretty much think that our Milky Way is built up from many mergers with these satellite galaxies of different masses. So I typically think about the orbital dynamics. So I'm very much a dynamicist, what you would think of in physics one or mechanics is a lot of what I do. Thinking about how, different bodies interact with each other. Like I said, those most massive ones are the most interesting to me because they're in an interesting regime where they're massive enough that it's not just the host galaxies kind of pushing around the small thing. At 10% of the mass of the host, they're also kind of big enough where they can influence the host a little bit too. And then on the opposite end, those satellite galaxies can also, pull and push around the even smaller satellites. So they're kind of in the middle regime where there's an effect on both sides. So yeah, I've been focusing a little bit more on things like Large Magellanic Cloud or M33, which are sort of analogs within the Milky Way and M31 system. So yeah, and mostly I do this all through simulations. I think that this is a very fast-moving field right now, so there's a few reasons why. One is the Gaia mission. So it's a space mission that's ongoing right now, and it's pretty much scanning the sky many, many times over in the same regions. And it's measuring the motion of over a billion stars in the Milky Way. And that's really cool because that means that we can now actually understand how many different objects within the galaxy itself, and then things that are around the galaxy, how they're moving in time. Whereas often, you look up at the sky with a telescope, you take a picture, and you know what it looks like right now, right? Or however many light years ago, depending on how far it is. But that doesn't really tell you what the history of it was. We're starting to understand the moving picture of what's going on, so we can kind of actually piece together the history without just saying, well, this is what our model says. Now we can actually compare the model to something that's been truly measured. While I've been a grad student, I've done a variety of different education and public outreach things, and so I've really liked working with kids and adults and teenagers and retired folks. So I'd like to keep doing that as well, both as a postdoc and then long term maybe as a full-time job. So I think many other people who have made it to my stage or past where I'm at in my career, probably often been one of the few women in the room, and it's definitely not easy. But it's the reality of what things are like now, and luckily I do think it's changing, which is nice. But I think the most important thing is to sort of like find your community, like find your people that are going to support you even when, you know, everyone might not be treating you the same as somebody else.
Hi, I'm Matthew.
And I'm Carolyn. Thanks so much for watching our newest Women of Discovery video. We hope you enjoyed it. Be sure to subscribe and tune in next week for our live session all about the making of this video.
If you have questions, either leave them below in the comments or join us for the live chat next week. Thanks for watching.